Good morning, one and all. Welcome to the technical session 5C of 5th International Conference on ICT4SD. Due to COVID-19, we all are going through a new normal phase. And the team of ICT4SD wishes you a safe and healthy time for you and your well-wishers. We are constantly trying to overcome the challenges that research community is facing at different levels. We at Global Knowledge Research Foundation are fully committed to contribute and enhance the digital experience in research activities. To continue further, this conference has received tremendous number of submissions, which has crossed more than 1,000 plus for more than 20 plus countries marked through direct submission and special sessions, out of which 340 papers are accepted by the technical review committee, and we were only able to accommodate 160 papers in two volumes of this year ICT4SD publication. Once again, congratulate you for your research work and would be glad to be part of this success story in the fifth version of this conference. Further, I would like to welcome our two chair, Dr. Priyanka Verma and Mr. Vinod Thumar. Dr. Priyanka Verma, Senior Assistant Professor in Department of Computer Science and IT, the IIS University. She has 10 years of teaching experience. The area of interest are Windows application, database application, web application, operating system, and programming languages. Furthermore, our next session chair, Dr. Vinod Thumar, working as a project head strategy design in Child Safety Technologies Private Limited, Ahmedabad. He has more than 18 years of experience in teaching and industry. Research areas are data security, artificial intelligence, and blockchain. I welcome you all. Now we would like to proceed further with our presentations. So our first presenter is Pranay Chauhan. I am unmuting you, Pranay. You can go ahead with the presentation.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Am I audible?
Yes, you are audible. Go ahead.
Okay. So good morning, one and all. I am Pranay Chauhan, from research scholar from ITDV Indore. Today I'm going to present my paper on a topic known as enhancing trust and emotivity in cloud investigation on science. Under the guidance of Mr. Pratosh Bansal, he is my guide and supervisor. And sir is also working as a professor and head in IT department here at ITDV Indore. So the content which I have included in my presentation is basically on introduction. Basically, it includes about the cloud, that what are the basically the goals of cloud are there and how cloud help us.
Pranay, is it possible you can just share your screen because we are not able to visible
okay,
your
okay, yes. Okay, sir. Sorry. Just a little bit of a minute. Sir, it's visible?
Yes, you can go ahead.
Okay. So the content I'm going to discuss today is on introduction about the cloud and what are the various processes in cloud, then about the various security issues, then about the solutions which are basically exist and how we can share the evidences and the various issues in the handling the evidences during the investigation process. And then we are going to, I'm going to present my proposed methodology and how we can optimize such issues. And then finally, we're going to discuss about the references. So as we know that the cloud computing is playing a very important and vital role in today's era. So today we are having this conference is also scheduled on the cloud platform. We can see that the Zoom is also sharing this platform, and we are using the Zoom platform, and it's a cloud-based platform. So as the cloud is also optimizing various issues for the system, such as the cost, storage, and security, there are various systems which basically exist in a traditional system. And the cloud is basically optimizing the such kind of issues. And as you know that cloud has no borders, we can easily access our data from anywhere. And it is the biggest advantage of cloud that our data can be accessed from anywhere in the world. And but this advantage can also be, this advantage has been misused by the criminals, because the criminal had also been using such cloud platform. And as there has been seen a drastic increase in the cloud-based crime in the recent past. I have referred a report of Gartner. And as per the report of Gartner, the cloud-based crime has been increased tremendously, and especially in the COVID era, where most of the things are being done online. So the crime has been also been increased in such era. The crimes such as social engineering attacks, including phishing and vishing, the financial frauds, which basically includes the debit card fraud and credit card frauds, And the fake news is also a big concern, because we have seen a lot of fake news has been spread over the social media. Especially we can call about Twitter and WhatsApp, Facebook. They all are the major sources of such kind of fake news. And the adultery fraud are also the major ones frauds. So these are the basically crime which are being conducted with the help of the cloud-based platform. Because the immorals are from any geolocation can target the victim of any geolocation, and even cross borders, because all over the world the cloud is providing us the facility for ease access of data. So the immorals are also using these platforms for conducting such kind of crime. And as the cloud, we can see that the cloud has providing us the solutions for DR services and for maintaining the business continuity. We can maintain our disaster plans and the recovery and the backups are being maintained over the disk and over the tape and over the client side and over the server side, and which are being maintained over globally. And the main issue which arrived during this such kind of things, advantage of cloud, is the challenge for the law enforcement agencies, because the law enforcement agencies are being struggling for getting some such kind of investigation process, because when the crime commit with the help of cloud-based platform, so it's quite tough for the law enforcement agencies to identify the criminals, and it's quite tough and quite a tedious process to get them the evidences. And during this entire process, the cloud forensics basically help in such cases. If we talk about the cloud forensic science, it's a new dimension in cloud security, which basically combine the computer forensic science and the cloud computing. We can say it is a combination of cloud computing as well as computer forensic science. So lots of been tools have been used during the investigation process. If I talk about some traditional tools such as FTK imager, imaging tool, OS forensic science, and Oxygen forensic science are being the major ones which can be used. And there's a vendor known as Magnet is working very good in case of cloud-based investigation. The Magnet is a basically company which basically help the law enforcement agencies in all over the India. If I talk about our research, I have conducted some research from the cyber cell, from the MP and from the Rajasthan and Gujarat. So what I have been included from my research that most of the cyber cells in MP, Gujarat and Rajasthan are being using this kind of tool known as Magnet Axiom Cyber, from which the law enforcement agencies can collect their evidences. And the cloud vendors such as Amazon Web Service, the Dropbox, the Slack, the Google Cloud platform, are from such platforms they can easily identify the evidences. But still there is a point of some kind of issues are there in the process of investigation, because as we have seen about the process of investigation, it takes basically about 4 to 5 phases. The first phase is about during investigation is about the identification of evidences and collection of evidences, because to identify the right evidence is a quite tough and critical task, and to collect all the evidences from all the major sources from cloud is again a major crucial task for the law enforcement agencies. And the second phase is acquisition phase, where they acquire all the evidences. And then third phase, they basically go for the phase of preservation, where they preserve the evidences. Then in fourth phase, basically they go for analysis, and then finally they go for reporting. And after reporting, they submit all these evidences, and they submit the evidences in the Honorable Supreme Court or Honorable Court. So these are the basically 5 phases which are being used during the investigation process. Our main research focus is basically, our main work is only on evidence identification and collection, which we are discussing in this paper. So how the law enforcement agencies collect the evidences and collect the cross-border evidences. We can see that existing solutions system for collecting evidences during cross-border crimes basically rely on this 4 type of system. The first system is using the email system, where the email has been used, and with the help of email system, basically the law enforcement agencies, they can share the evidences with one another. The second the system which basically law enforcement agencies use is called MLAT, which is called Mutual Legal Assistance Treaty. And with the help of this MLAT program, they can exchange the evidences cross border, and with the help of this MLAT, they collect the evidences from other countries. But the main issue with this MLAT program is that it is quite lengthy process, and it required a lot of political effort also, because the countries used to refuse the evidences process, and they used to refuse this process for the collecting evidences. And the third process is through CSP web portals. The CSP have, a lot of the CSP have provide the web portals to the law enforcement officers, And this law enforcement officers, basically, they use the CSP portal. And with the help of this, they can share the evidences and they can exchange the data. And the fourth and the most important, nowadays we are seeing that the storage laws have been helping the law enforcement officers for exchanging evidences. Here, I will talk about the Cloud Act and about the data localization. These are basically two laws which have been helping the law enforcement officers for collecting the evidences. Now, firstly, I will talk about the email system. Because as you know that the email communication is one of the most important common way for exchanging the critical information about the evidences. The law enforcement agencies, they directly demand the information from the cloud vendor or the concerned authority. They just drop a mail on the given mail ID, and after sharing the mail ID, they can demand the evidences. But these authorities might take quite weeks and quite time to respond to such emails. I have collected some evidence also from the Microsoft. I will show you.
My last 2 minutes.
Okay, sir. So let me go for the final presentation. So this is a system which is quite a complex system. Then we can talk about the other system is known as the emulity system, in which the lots of complex process is there. So in this system, basically, the authorities to done lots of steps are involved. The first authority will concern to the state authorities, and the state authorities will transfer it to the central authority, and they will, the process will reverse and vice versa. So the existing solutions such as email, MLAT, and we can say the cloud service portals, they are quite complex process and they require lots of time and lots of effort. And sometimes the authorities are also, they refuse to provide the evidences. So what we are proposing in our solution, we are proposing a solution for, then we can use a blockchain based platform for exchanging the evidences. So what I have done a research, and according to our research, we will conclude our research in this following part. That if we are going to use a blockchain platform, so blockchain platform will help us in collecting the evidences, and we can collect the evidences with the help of this blockchain platform. And the blockchain, with the help of the smart contract, we can easily exchange the evidences globally. And after exchanging the evidences, the person of a police force agency can might exchange the evidences, and without any trouble, they can exchange the evidences. And the most important thing that we have seen in the existing solutions, that this problem can also be optimized with the help of such problem. So our proposed architecture, we propose about the smart contract platform. Here we are going to use a permission based platform, in which we are trying to use a Hyperledger, and we are trying to use a Wave blockchain platform. With the help of, we can exchange the evidences, and through this, the law enforcement agencies plus the prosecution plus the defense, and plus the permission for the expert and permission to investigation agencies and the court of law, and as well as authorities. So they will not face any trouble, and with the help of the blockchain platform and with the help of this our smart contract platform, they can easily put all the evidences on the smart contract. And with the help of the smart contract, the evidences will be in the immutable form, and the trust and transparency will be maintained in all the system. And this will also help our the prosecution as well as defense, as well as the law enforcement agencies for exchanging the evidences. And the problem which we have seen in the MLAT and during that email, and the CSP web portals, that sometimes it has been seen that most of the time the evidence has been tampered. The file of evidences had been tampered, and the agencies have been struggling for getting the right evidences. And the integrity and trust has been not been there in the evidences. So now to solve all this problem, the blockchain can help us, and the blockchain is a very good solution for the same system. We can convert all the evidence in the form of smart contract, and then this smart contract can be deployed on the blockchain. And with the help of the blockchain, we can provide the permission to over all involved persons and the agencies. And if they are having the private key, and with the help of the private key, they can easily generate the logs, and they can easily generate and they can easily share the evidences. So it will maintain the trust and the transparency in the entire system. So through this system, the trust and transparency can be maintained. And with the help of this blockchain-based evidence sharing platform, we can achieve the trust and privacy. And especially all the parties will be get the right evidences, and there will be no issue of, there is no issue of transparency, and the issues are there. So this is all about my presentation in short presentation in 8 to 8 minutes. So if you have any problem, you can just, if you have any question, please ask, so I can try to answer.
Thank you, Pranay. Dr. Priyanka and Vinod, sir.
Pranay.
Yeah, sir.
I have one question.
Yeah, sir. Sure, please.
You told that whenever any kind of breach or fraud there, then agency get information from cloud service provider, right?
Yeah.
In case of a cloud service provider, if they did the fraud on the data from the client, then what will be the system to track the fraud done by the cloud service provider?
Okay, so actually what we have done, so actually we have seen the lots of vendors. For example, we have seen about the Amazon Web Service. So what they do, they maintain a system for log handling system, for which they generate logs for each and every system.
No. My question is that to tracking the external attack, they can have a log. But in case if they have the employee from the organization of the cloud service provider, if that person has made any mistake, and they try to did the fraud, then what will be the solution?
Yeah, so actually, sir, in that case, the cyber law will help, sir. For example, if you talk about the Europe, if the vendors in Europe, sir, we can call for the GDPR law. If they're in case of India, we can call the data localization law. And if there is in the case of US, we can call the California Act. So in this case, the law will help, sir. We can use the law.
Have you read the terms and conditions of the any cloud service provider?
Yes, sir. Actually, I have read some conditions. I have some documents. And sir, as a document, sir, sometimes they refuse to give and they refuse to share information, sir. Most of the time, they refuse to share the information.
No, terms and conditions from any cloud service provider are publicly open. First, try to read the terms and service condition of the Google. They told that they can use your data, they can publish, they can modify, they can reproduce your data anywhere for any purpose. So, that directly or indirectly, we are giving the permission rights to them to use our data. So sure, in that case, what we can do?
So actually, sir, Google is providing data. So actually, I have also seen the report of Google, sir. Actually, but the problem is Google only provide information to the only to particular specific vendor, sir. Sir, I have seen the report of Google. Okay, how Google will respond to our data, sir. Most of the time, they refuse to, sir, give the report because the current report is from October 18, which I have got from Google platform. So, sir, they had not mentioned about such kind of policies that we are not going to share the information with the customer and we are not sharing the information with the law enforcement agencies. So, this is a main issue, sir, because they are not sharing the information and they are not giving the information to the law enforcement officers. So, for the same, there is no transparency in the system, because the system is not transparent. They are not giving and sharing the complete detail about the fraud. And for instance, when data breach occur from their side, they just say, we are in the process of investigation. We are working on the same. Sir, we have seen last week about Twitter hack. The Twitter hack is the same example for the system. And Twitter is still not giving information about the system. So, sir,
Okay. One more question regarding the implementation which you have completed in your blockchain.
Yes, sir.
You have designed the immutable system, okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay. In case if any person has uploaded the wrong information or wrong data on the blockchain, then in that case, what we can do?
So actually, suppose it is
an immutable system.
Yeah, sir. It's a immutable system. So in that case, sir, we had to again go for VADV demand. So again, we will demand the new type of log, sir, and that transaction will be added in the new block, sir. We got for the same the block which can't be which cannot be opened, the dead block. We can't alter the block because it's immutable. So we will demand, we will demand a new kind of system. I mean, demand new kind of evidence and that evidence will include in new block. So that added answer we can't do such because this is a blockchain based platform. So it is immutable.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Good day, sir.
Thank you, Pranay. Priyanka, ma'am, you have any question?
I guess now we can call up our next participant. That is Mr. K.
Rajeshwar. I think so. K. Rajeshwar is not available. So we can just go ahead with the next presentation of Archana Singh. Archana, I had unmuted you. Go ahead with the presentation.
Okay. Thank you. Good afternoon to everyone. My paper ID presentation is 169. I just share my screen with you. So is this shareable?
Yes, go ahead.
Okay. Our paper title is Deep Learning Techniques in Image Description. I and my co-author Prateek Gupta, he works with Adobe System. We together work on this paper. Our paper ID is 169. Basically the motivation behind this work is, like, we wanted to find out the caption of the images. However, it has been found by using so many machine learning techniques, but people have not used the hybrid approach so far. This is the objective of this paper. Since the current era of high-end GPU with the exploring set of data requires in-depth knowledge of deep learning techniques, and where we are, it is basically the combination of computer vision and natural language processing, which has attracted huge IT attention. In this paper, we have used the data sets which is already available, and we have applied the hybrid deep learning models, CNN, and CNN-RNN. Not individually, but the hybrid approach we have used, and we have found that which model is performing better. And it has been found that CNN has got a better accuracy of results than CNN-RNN. As we know, deep learning is taking a lot of popularity in identifying, analyzing, and for better accuracy of image feature extraction. Rather, we don't use this word extraction whenever we are talking about deep learning models, because it does not just provide the extraction, but it provides the deep feature engineering. We use this word like, as deep learning models, they deep dig each and every feature, and they take strides, and as a programmer, we can customize the strides in every layer, taking those conventional layer to max pooling, and we can bring out the better accuracy of features. It has been found in machine learning, if the accuracy of results is 70%, then with deep learning models, the accuracy is 90% of the same data set. This is what the extant research is giving us. The paper focuses on the model to describe image description. As I just mentioned, it requires the combination of image processing, computer vision, NLP. And we have used lexicons. We have described the lexicons to give the caption to the image. The purpose of this research is basically like for blind people. Blind people, they cannot have that aesthetic sense. They don't have that hedonic sense of any image. But if we connect our work where image is input and description is there, caption is there to that image, and if we connect that caption with the voice, and the voice just goes in the air, ears of a blind people, they can just imagine, they can just visualize things in their brain. The key difference to the proposed model is that we have used two LSTM rather than one LSTM, which has been again observed in the extant research that many researchers, they have used one LSTM instead of two, where we are using two LSTM models, long short term models, because reason being, one is generating the weight and another is giving the caption, which is bringing more accuracy to our results. That means our model is basically based on encoder and decoder steps. There are two steps. This is just an example. Like, this is what is the objective that we are doing. This is an input image from Google. You just put any image, and the caption which is coming on the top of the image: man is standing on top of cliff overlooking the ocean. Now, how it's working is, this is a natural language processing where deep learning is doing object detection. Like, how many objects are there in this image? This, we can see a man, we can see a cliff, we can see the ocean. Now these top of the cliff, like we are concatenating all these nouns together, and we are giving few words also. Like, when we were training our model, we were getting a lot of error. Like, it was even assuming this ocean as a sea, ocean as a simple stream of water. At times, it was even considered as a fountain. So to remove those errors, we have used two LSTM to bring out the better accuracy to the caption. As I just mentioned, that in this proposed work, we actually compare two models, the two hybrid models together. One, we have used CNN-RNN, and then we have used CNN-CNN. these are the data sets that we have. It is already available, and we have used the concept of transfer learning. MS COCO data set, it has got around 30 lakh images. 3 lakh images, more than 2 million instances, and 30,000 images is there in Flickr 30 data set. It is there easily available. We have used both the existing data sets. This is the way, these are the steps, like we are taking, our input layer is there, images going on, then we are passing the sequence of indexes, partial caption. Then indexes are getting mapped to 200 dimensional vector that you can customize when you are developing deep learning models. We have implemented the whole model in Python. And then we are just finding out the images. This is the third layer, which is the dropout layer. This layer is added to basically avoid this overfitting of the model. This is one of the big disadvantage of deep learning models, where generally you end up in overfitting of the model. And this is the architecture, the flowchart that we have used. The proposed model can give long and complex text as description of the image. It used RNN to store the previous ways and keep continuing forwards for the same. It used long short term memory. It is basically advanced version of RNN. Rather, we didn't use pure RNN, but we have used LSTM because it keeps the record of the previous weight that you have used. Otherwise, RNN just loses the previous way that we have used. CNN, LSTM layers working together.
Archana ma'am, last 2 minutes.
Okay. This is the way, like this, we have used. This is the working of RNN and CNN models. And the main problem that we faced when we were using this model, that it is not giving us more optimized solution. That's why, and it is giving us loss in every layer. To prevent that loss in the layer, we moved on to from RNN to CNN. Then we tried to hybrid both CNN and CNN together. This is the basic framework of CNN model that I'm not explaining as because this we take an image, then we go for a conventional pooling, dense and output layer, where this is a very basic example where it just describes whether it's a cat or a dog. Unlike LSTM, CNN has got a better accuracy, as just mentioned. CNN is utilized to override repetitive model, delivering more precise results. Hence, it actually speed up the process by the factor of 9, which is quite significant to be noted. The accuracy of results were found better in CNN than RNN. The proposed model, it takes more time, as just mentioned, and it brings out more authentication of features from image. The results are just mentioned and shown. These are this is just one example. Like, we have actually worked with various images and we found out the caption very with better accuracy. This is the conclusion and the future scope of work. I just describe it here. However, this slide looks very not very good. The future is where we would like to add the perception of the image. Like, if an image of a cat is there, then of the user, the blind, we are giving the perception also. The cat is sweet. The cat is quite cute. This is my next approach, scope of work that we could add with the existing work. We are basically just want to develop an aesthetic model for blind people. Thank you so much. These are few references. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, Archana. Vinod sir and Priyanka ma'am.
Yes,
Archana, I have a question from you.
Yes, ma'am.
You just mentioned in the beginning about that you have made use of deep neural models. Apart from this, have you worked on anything else also? I mean, did you review some other method also?
Yes, ma'am. We have used this ResNet 50 in Google Net. We have used this ResNet 50 model also.
Which model?
ResNet 50. Ma'am, Google, like we have AlexNet, Google Net, ResNet, we have used Google Net model also. ResNet, we have used ResNet 50, the advanced version of ResNet, which is ResNet 50. Am I audible, okay. Ma'am?
Okay. Actually, your voice is cracking, so I'm not able to hear what you are saying.
Okay, ma'am, I just write down in the chat. It's not accessible to me. The chat window is not accessible to me.
Okay, never mind, Arjuna. I guess...
ma'am, I just write down... ma'am, my answer is here. I'm just writing here. Like, we have used this ResNet 50. This model we have okay. used. We have used ResNet 50, which is the advanced version of ResNet.
Okay, fine, Arjuna. Thank you so much.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
Yeah, Vinod, sir.
Yes, Arjuna, madam. Yes. There is one question.
Sir, even your voice is not that great to me.
Yes, now it is audible.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Okay. My question is that have you defined any particular criteria while selection of your images?
No, not really, sir. Like we are taking scenes, like sceneries, and because we want to give aesthetic sense to the blind people. So we just selected the images which are having that sceneries into it.
Yes, not my, it's a scenery, but a particular criteria, because there are lots of file formats for the images. So your model will work on each and every format? Have you tested that?
Yes, sir. We have already tested, validated. Like the data set that we have used two data set. One is for the test, training our model, and another is for the testing the model.
And in case I have taken one snapshot from mobile and the image was
damaged. Yes, sir, it will work. The accuracy, I cannot give you the guarantee, but any image you just browse and send in our model, which you just put in our model, it will pick all the nouns which are described in our database. Majorly, like
in case I have taken image through my mobile, and at that time that picture also will be taken from your system?
Yes, sir. It can be taken. Yes, sir.
Okay.
It's okay.
Thank you.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Good. Thank you, Archana. Thank you.
Thank you.
Now I would like to invite our next presenter, Pratik Gupta. Pratik, just I had unmuted you. You can just go ahead.
Hello, everyone. Good afternoon. This is Pratik Gupta. Am I audible to you all?
Yes, Pratik. Go ahead.
Let me start by screen share, and as I do a screen share, I hope and I pray that everybody is safe and healthy in these COVID times. Let me start by sharing screen. My apologies, it is taking time. I'll have to quit and rejoin as it was not allowing me to do a screen share. Give me a minute, I'll be right back.
Fine, we will go ahead with the next presentation. You can just quit, otherwise you can just check the share screen option on the below.
It's actually more to do with the security that is set up on my laptop. So I've just enabled that. Zoom is not the preferred video conferencing tool for us. So just installed and got this set up. So give me a minute, I shall be right back. My apologies.
No issue. Now we would like to invite our next presenter, Soumya Algrani. I had already unmuted you. You can just go ahead with the presentation and share screen.
Yes, thank you so much. Okay, I'll start by share my screen, okay? Am I clear?
Yeah, go ahead.
Thank you. My name is Soumya Algrani. I am a master's student at University of East Anglia. First of all, I would like to take this opportunity to thank you for the conference committee and to thank you very much everyone here for taking the time out of your busy schedule to be with me today. In today's presentation, I will discuss one of the most important topics in the field of computer security nowadays. Actually, it's not only important for people majoring in computer science, but for individual and organization all over the world, as anyone could be a victim of a cybersecurity attack. Therefore, I have chosen a recent cybersecurity attack as the topic of my presentation to be discussed and analyzed today. My aim is to address how such attack could be reduced or prevented in the future. Okay, let's go to my next slide. Among many cyber attacks that have happened over the past few years, I have chosen one called WannaCry ransomware attacks, and it occurred in May 2017 and affected many countries all over the world. This attack infected computers across the globe and crippled individual and organization alike. There are many countries affected by this viruses or this attacks, and United Kingdom was one of the countries largely affected by this, especially the National Health Service in the United Kingdom. My presentation today will analyze this ransomware attacks, and I will try to go through the most important topic related to this. Okay, let's begin with a brief introduction to this topic. With globalizations and recent technological advance and the revolution in information and communication technologies, the communication barriers have been reduced and people all over the world are connecting with each other through networks. This has made it easier for us to communicate and exchange knowledge and services and everything, etc. However, in the same time, this connectivity has also allowed an high opportunity for malicious software and for other cyber security threats to spread easily among users through the networks. Such attacks threaten individual and organization worldwide, and many have fallen victims to such ransomware attacks or other different attacks of this type. Indeed, the threat of ransomware in particular has risen in the last few years. And in 2017, as I mentioned, the world witnessed one of the most destructive ransomware attacks in the history of the internet. This attack is known, as I mentioned, and as shown, is WannaCry, and it affected users across the globe, crippling individual and organization in many countries. In my presentation, I will try to highlight this attack and consider some essential information and will be discussed now. What's the ransomware? What's the type of it? WannaCry ransomware attacks, I will explain this a little bit. And how WannaCry infected computers, and the last things about prevention of similar attacks in the future. Okay. Okay, before analyzing the WannaCry ransomware attack, it's important for us to understand what's ransomware mean and how it works. Ransomware is a blanket term used in computer science to describe any piece of malicious software that block users from accessing their files. The ransomware usually encrypt files, and the only way to resign access to your file is by using a decryption key, usually received after paying a ransom. The first ransomware attacks in the history was in 1989 and known as AIDS Trojans, and was spread with floppy disk. Sorry? May I continue?
Yeah, you can continue.
Yeah, it is spread with floppy disk, and I think about 90 countries has been affected at that time. Since then, hackers have developed many more sophisticated ransomware programs that cripple users from their computers. Ransomware usually threatens to wipe all information stored in the devices unless the requested ransomware has been paid. However, even if the user pays for the ransom, there's no guarantee that he can get access to his files or his data. Okay. Now I'm going to give in this slide, I'm going to give the type or explain briefly the type of ransomware. There are two main types of ransomware program. The first one is encrypting type, or crypto ransomware as it's called. This type includes advanced encryption algorithm designed to block users' files through encryption key. And the only way to unlock this file again is through using the decryption key that's given by them. And it's usually provided for people after paying a ransom. The second type is a locker type, which usually look user out of their operating system, not only through files, until payment is made. Crypto lockers, Locky and Cribol are example of the former one, while WinLockers is an example of the latter one. Okay. Now I'm going to give an important overview of WannaCry attacks. As I said at the beginning of the presentation, the WannaCry ransomware attacks happened on 12 May 2017 and estimated that over 200,000 endpoints were affected globally. Hackers requested Fixin to pay ransom of about $300 in bitcoins, which usually used for that. It was reported that the amount of money paid at the first 3 days exceeds $70,000 or $60,000. Okay, one of the most important reasons for the rapid spread of WannaCry at that time, as it was unlike the traditional malicious software that using phishing email, the WannaCry using a weakness in Microsoft system SMB, which is Server Message Block Protocol, named Ethernet. It infected system through this port, and this make them quickly spread to other devices on the network. Okay, who's affected? The WannaCry ransomware attack. Okay, regarding the victim of WannaCry, the first attack were reported in the United Kingdom, and the other then it spread to all other countries in Europe, as well as in the United States, in India, in China, in Taiwan, in Ukraine, in Russia, and many other countries. The attacks not only affect individual users, but also business in many sectors, such as healthcare, such as travel, such as telecom, security services, manufacturing, and many others. On this side, on this slide are some examples that affected by this, which is, for example, the National Health Services United Kingdom, FedEx Company, Reno, Nissan, and many others. Okay. In this slide, we are going to discuss dealing with WannaCry and preventing similar attacks in future. Now we will discuss some very important information, how to deal with WannaCry attacks or similar attacks in futures when becoming effective, and the procedure that could the person use to take to prevent such attacks before they happen. The information is very important for individual as many as for organization worldwide. Okay, if a system is infected with WannaCry, user will only have a few responsive procedures can be taken. User can either pay ransom, as I said earlier, or hopefully rely on backups if they have. Okay, this may be the only choice for affected user. Security experts have released many tools like WannaKeys or other tools to help user fight against this ransomware. In reality, however, these tools have limited ability and are unable to recover file in most scenarios. However, even if user pay the ransom, as we mentioned earlier, there is no guarantee their files will be recovered. Given this scenario, we can conclude that the best way to deal with such attacks is to take some preventive procedures that aim to preventing such attacks from happening at the first place. This procedure could be taken in two levels, on the organizational levels and also in the individual level, and they include usually similar steps. Okay.
Last two minutes, Sumaya.
Here are the most important procedures that should be considered, and each is similar in priority. The procedure including backup data, update antivirus, install Microsoft critical patches, block vulnerable ports, okay? Use sandbox and VSM, and also exercise cautions when opening emails or receiving any files or anything through the email, and not open anything until we are guaranteed where we got this file or this attachment. All of these procedures could help to prevent users and organizations from becoming affected of similar attacks in the future. Okay, in conclusions, according to many researchers and security experts, ransomware like WannaCry is the most dangerous and disrupting threat currently faced by individual organization worldwide. Unfortunately, there are no mechanisms to decrypt files encrypted by such ransomware. The only way to minimize the damage is by taking the, as we said, the procedures or the attacks to prevent such attacks in the first place. Okay, this is my presentation. Here is some reference. And at the last, thank you so much for your attention. And you are more than welcome to ask any questions. Thank you so much.
Yeah. Vinod sir and Priyanka ma'am.
No question from my side.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Priyanka.
Yes, Sumaya. I have a question from you.
Excuse me, I'm not I'm not hearing credible. Yes, yes, ma'am.
I have a question from you. You said that WannaCry and ransomware are detected somewhere around 1990, right? So, could you just give me one example as to where
that detected? Could you please write that on the chat? I can't hear very well because
Priyanka, ma'am, actually you are not audible. So, if possible, you can directly write the question to the chat board. Your internet connection is very poor, so might be we are not able to audible you.
Yeah, I can't actually hear.
Sumaya, you can receive the question from the ma'am, so you can directly write it down, the answer of.
Yeah, okay, no problems.
Now I would like to again verify, we don't have a two presenter, the K Rajeshwar and Vijay Verma is not available, so we would like to proceed with the last presentation, which is Pratik Gupta. Pratik.
Yes, thank you so much. I'm back and I want to test screen sharing. Is my screen visible to all?
Perfect, go ahead.
Thank you so much and apologies for the earlier disruption. Today, I plan to present phishing website detection using machine learning algorithm. Paper ID 202. With me, my co-author is just talking about deep learning and image bot classification. Going further into my presentation, here is the agenda I plan to cover. Abstract, introduction, what's my motivation, what are the focus areas, what's the research, few of the highlights in the interest of time, and then discussion and conclusion in future scope of work. Moving on to abstract, phishing, we all know, and picking some of the theme of our presentations today, cyber security, which was given by one of my fellow colleagues earlier, that phishing is basically increasing day by day. In the post-COVID era, when every industry is trying to go digital, going digital is not a choice but a necessity. Phishing crimes are increasing. How do we define phishing? Phishing is nothing but employing social engineering and technical subterfuge to steal consumers' personal identity data and financial account credentials. This is nothing but a crime. As we go further down the road and analyze various patterns, there is an opportunity for us to identify these patterns proactively and protect personal identifiable information and sensitive personal information of our consumers, of our customers, for their betterment and for ensuring that their financial data does not get compromised in any which way. Various machine learning algorithms are studied, which can be leveraged for safeguarding users from these spoofed websites by identifying patterns. A lot of work has been done. This is my preliminary work, and I plan to build on this work as we go further along in this. Moving on to the next slide, in terms of what has been the trend and what has been the motivation. I started working on this somewhere prior to COVID 2019, and at that point of time, phishing was still picking up in various industries. But during the COVID-19, it has actually gone off the roof. And some of the sectors which were impacted not that much, for example, healthcare, we have seen a sudden increase in phishing attempts there, all right? Some of the medical facilities which are now available online, when consumer is trying to access or consume those, there is an attempt to steal their personal information. If we compare this with Western countries, where there is a strong compliance and regulatory mechanism, and there are strict punishments in case someone is caught doing phishing, it is not the case in India. In India, people generally get away by doing phishing. So, as we go further along in these discussions, the call is to put stronger regulatory and compliance mechanisms and back it up with strict laws so that phishing can be controlled in a sustainable manner. here, as we look at the trend, March 20 from Feb 20, and the numbers have increased significantly. And if we go from number 190 to March 20, it has gone significantly again. There are various techniques. One is blacklisting, something that we have been using in the past, where we take users' feedback and identify which of the websites are actually spoofing websites. Today, there is an opportunity with a better compute and processing techniques available, leveraging cloud, we can actually churn large amount of data and put together some good deep learning algorithms and machine learning algorithms, which can proactively identify and give us patterns and give us meaningful output. As I was speaking earlier about the phishing sectors, this is a research study in terms of what are the most targeted phishing sector. We see financial institutions, payments, and it brings me to an interesting incident that happened a few days back, where we were teaching a group of first-time female drivers who were trying to learn how to do payment via Paytm. And all this like spoofing websites, they do target those first-time users. And as more and more people are adopting digital technologies, that's an area of vulnerability. And if you do more work on phishing, identifying phishing sectors effectively, this will help us curb that. Here I'll try to highlight some of the lexical features or the URL-based features which can be identified easily using machine learning algorithms. When we see a URL based on domains, subdomains, and special characters, we can identify. We divide the URL into tokens, and then from these tokenization, we feed an input to machine learning algorithms. Some of the ones that we used during the study were logistic regression, a random forest, and support vector machines. Here is the one where we analyzed an IP address. This is an interesting pattern. And what we also identified is when we used that some of the IP addresses gets converted into an hexadecimal format. And that is an indicator that it's a spoofing website. There's a potential of it to be a spoofing website. Lengthy URLs, they conceal the malicious intent. When we analyze data of about 10,000 odd websites, URLs, it gave us that URL length, if it's less than 54, it's legitimate. If it's 54 to 75, it's suspicious. And otherwise, if it's greater than 75, we can clearly tag it as phishing. Tiny URLs are also something that can be identified as a phishing or a spoofing source. Using so many of these services, they try to put a detrimental attack by shortening down the URLs or tiny URLs. @symbol character. I have just listed few of these here, but there are others that that we analyzed. Related to HTTPS, the secure socket layer, because most of the attacks today are happening on the HTTPS layer. Second, the port. If there is a legitimate port number that is being targeted or not. Here, I'm talking about redirecting using double slash. So if the position of the last occurrence of double slash in the URL is greater than 7, it's phishing. This was an interesting pattern, which I did not know before I went into study, and I could not see this in one of the previous research papers. Server form handler, there's a misspell there, it's not from, it's form. And whenever server form handler is blank, it's phishing, and there is something tricky about it. And in terms of discussions, now, if, as we see the statistical highlights for first quarter 2020, we see the number of unique phishing websites that are getting detected has increased from 49,000 to 60,000. And I'm sure that it does not have the data from April to June. But if we start looking at that data, it would give us inputs that the number has gone up from 60,000 to probably 70,000 or 80,000. And this is an indicator that as we tighten up our security, there are phishers and spoofers who are using new and new mechanisms to break that security. One of the things that I wish to take forward is to basically use sentiment analysis, because whenever these phishing companies, they try to target you, they try to lure you into some kind of an offer. They try to call you for, they try to put together a call for action. So if I could analyze an email and identify a sentiment, that would help me increase the accuracy and detect these phishing websites more effectively. Earlier, there were only few sectors which were predominantly adopted digital, but now the reach is more, something that I covered in the early part of the call. There are new phishing sources, the WhatsApp messages have become in-app advertisement, which has been there for some time, but that has now increased. Frequent fire programs, banks, and the then the need of the hour is to actually do a real-time processing and release proactive alerts.
I think last 1 minute.
Sure. We have batching use cases and we have streaming use cases. In batch processing, we have been very effective where we have large set of data and we could use big data technologies to actually process and put together result. But it becomes a tricky to provide an effective output or effective recommendation, whether it's a phishing or a not, using real-time streaming processing. Cyber security, those laws need to be strengthened, something that my colleague also spoke about. And it's important for anybody who's releasing an app to follow ethics. Ethics is to make sure that at no point of time, the data is getting compromised and is protected in the security vault. Sorry for that. That's my son asking for a geometry box. This is the conclusion. As I said, I've covered that. So these are a few references. Over to you.
Prateek, sorry to interrupt you in between. Could you move on to your previous slide where the table is there?
Yes, please.
Yes, in this table, can you just tell me how come in the month of February there has been a drop down in all the values, and in March again the values have increased? So was there some specific reason for it, or it's just like that?
Generally, phishing does happen during a particular event, right? So they look at opportunities. For example, at the time of Thanksgiving, you would see a spike and people would like to, you're getting so many messages, there is a high tendency, high probability of you clicking on some of their URLs. In February, we only have Valentine's Day, so to say, which provides an opportunity. But in the month of January, you see at the time of New Year, there is tons of opportunity. There's Martin Luther's King Day, that's tons of opportunity. And so that's probably why we see an anomaly in the trend, so to say.
Okay. But March does not have any specific festival, does it?
March, it's the summertime. That's the change of season. So you are basically moving away.
Okay. From,
and that's why there is an increase. So people start... Okay. Releasing new sales and sale offers and coupons, etc.
Okay, fine. Thank you so much, Prateek.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yes, Vinod, sir.
Prateek, sir.
Yes, sir.
Can you listen to me?
Yes, sir. You are audible, sir.
Okay, you have very well defined all the terminology like URL, domain, subdomain, and you can detect the phishing characters in that, okay? So my question is that in the case, we can see that there are few advertisement based on the image. And whenever we click on that image, then there is a hidden link after that image, which can divert the user to the another website. And it can be a phishing website. So can we detect that?
Yes, sir. Sir, I did not cover that particular feature here, but in that case, we go to the code behind, we look through the JavaScript, which is there on the on the front end, and we are able to identify certain patterns which gives us a view. So thank you for asking that great question, because nowadays what is happening is these advertisements that we see on YouTube videos.
Very frequently such type of videos as well as images in the market.
So that's my next goal, to actually put together something which can detect a phishing link in an ad on a video. Right now I'm able to do it only on an image. On a video, it's a little tricky that I need to work upon.
Okay, wish you all the best for this.
Thank you.
Thank you, Pratik. Now I would like to invite Dr. Amit Joshi for the closing remark. Sir, over to you.
Thank you very much, everyone, all the presenters, and specifically the session chairs, Dr. Priyanka and Dr. Vinod Thumar, who have considered their valuable time, and they have been so patient listeners for last 1.5 hours listening to the presentations from the people and then commenting on those presentations, because it is very tedious nowadays. We are sitting for every meeting and every task on a computer screen for long number of hours. So I really appreciate your gesture that you have given so much time and considering my request, and thank you very much. And I would like my team to just showcase a token of appreciation to both of those chairs, Dr. Priyanka Verma and Dr. Vinod Chimmar. Thank you very much. We will be sharing this certificate and a thank you letter to you digitally, because unfortunately we are not able to meet it physically for the conference. We should have been in Goa right this point of time, but unfortunately the world has moved digital and so are we. Anyways, but we hope that we will see everyone in physical nature and for the year 2021 for this particular conference. I am also happy to share that this conference have a history now for 5 years and has have a session with almost 4,000 to 5,000 researchers in these last 5 years. From more than 100 institutions and organizations across the world. So we are growing, and with this, our research backup research team is growing. And we look forward to all support of all the authors also in near future, in any possible way, in any collaborative way, we can do more effectively things. You are most welcome to collaborate and to write to me personally at amit@gr.foundation. My next part and is due for the all the authors who have presented their paper, contributed a paper, and then finally will wait for the publication. It's a cycle of almost 7 to 8 months when an author submits a paper, and then it's get reviewed, then you receive the review comments, you again revise your paper, and then you wait for your presentation during the conference. It used to be physically, but currently it is more effectively digitally happening, and then again waiting for the paper to get published. So it's a cycle time of 7 to 8 months, and author need to be patient. And believe me, if we talk about authors, that authors are not only students, they are top bureaucrat sometimes, they are top head of some institutions, some companies sometimes, they are active researchers of or head of research departments in some of the universities, they can be PhD scholars. So we have a variety of people who are coming across all these things, and I thank you very much to all those people who have been contributing and trusting us for this conference. Thank you very much. And my last part for authors also, that you will also receive your certificates, your payment receipt, and a thank you letter from our organization just after this session is over. So I really thank you. The last part is regarding the paper publication process. So again, we have already submitted the data to Springer for publication, and now it's in hand of Springer. What we are analyzing in last 3 to 4 months is Springer is really working very fast, and we hope that the publication is completed in next maybe 4 months or so, and in under normal circumstances, but it may take slightly less or more time depending on the number of queries we are facing in between. And if there are any queries, we will definitely write to you for getting your inputs back. Thank you very much. And I think there are a few people from other countries also in this session as well. So good morning again, good evening again, and good afternoon again. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much. I would like to thank you once again
to
all the
participants.
Thank you, ma'am. I would like to again thank you to all the participants. If you have any particular query regarding the conference, you can directly write it to the support team. We are happy to help you. Thank you. Stay safe, stay healthy. Thanks a lot.
Thank you so much, sir.